blindness, kidney failure, others. And the Buddhist religious is divided into two major books. It's type 1 and type 2 diabetes. In this video, I will demonstrate what is diabetes mellitus. Type 1 diabetes, it is progressive beta cell failure, characterized by decrease of insulin. Normally, physiologically, anything we eat contains carbohydrates. It moves into our stomach and disturbs a certain enzymatic activities in the stomach, in the small intestine. This is to change into a very minor particle called glucose. Before the glucose being absorbed into our blood, with this needs to move to a peripheral organ, it's called the pancreas. This pancreas has receptors for the presence of glucose. Once it senses the presence of glucose, it starts to produce certain hormones called insulin. Inside the pancreas, this is the beta cells. These beta cells have these receptors. Once it senses the presence of glucose, it starts to produce insulin. Insulin is the hormone responsible for depending in receptors on all of the body tissues in the heart and in the retina. They open certain gates for glucose to enter inside the tissues. Now, what happened in diabetes that the patients have destruction in the beta cells in case of type 1 and type 2. Most of their patients have destruction only also in the beta cells, but they are some of them characterized by destruction in the receptors for this. Injection would be the only treatment in case of type 1 diabetes. So diabetes is like a major infection. The body has a major infection, so the body starts to deteriorating and deteriorating and deteriorating until it's technically lost. It's just like a puzzle. There is no need of glucose in the absence of insulin. You treat it, you produce insulin, you treat it diabetes. Treatment, type 1 diabetes represents about 15% of the patients, type 2 represents about 85%. Based on an organization called the GTRF, Juvenile Diabetes Research Foundation, stated that the type 1 diabetic patient needs from 2 to 5 injections per day to control his blood glucose. Also, he needs several blood testing every day to monitor his blood glucose. In cases of type 1 and type 2 diabetes, they need drugs like metformin and cytokine releases. These drugs, in my opinion, this is just such a waste of resources. What kind of treatment I would give to patients by ordering him to inject himself 2 to 5 days per day and to monitor his blood glucose level in case of type 1 and or giving himself drugs to maximize the production of insulin in case of type 2 and then it's also in its amount. So it's a very common scenario that a type 2 diabetic patient, due to the administration of these drugs, he put a huge stress in the beta cells he have. So he starts a progression and he becomes a type 1 diabetic patient, and the injection will be the only treatment. Also, research proved that even under this restricted blood regime therapy, the blood glucose could not be controlled effectively, and the diabetic patient is at every minute risk of all of the complications of diabetes, from hyperglycemic tolerance and others. Unfortunately, medicine is keep thinking in the same way he thought in some diseases. He's treating a symptom, treating a hyperglycemic. He wants to treat another diabetic patient have a high blood glucose level, so we'll inject him with insulin to decrease his blood glucose. This is not the cause. The cause of the diabetic patient is have a destruction in the beta cells. This is the cause of the disease. So this took me to ask myself a question. How the state of the beta cells? I want to read about the histology of the beta cells. So I started to read about the histology of the beta cells in the normal and diabetic patient. First slide showing another picture of a normal person showing no area of necrosis cells, but having a great sequence. There is no area of necrosis or other substances. But the diabetic patient, the exact slide shows great areas of necrosis, shows an unsequencing. This is maybe due to the destruction and endoplasmic reticulum or something, but it also shows that there is still a number of cells living. You can see in the second slide, there is still living cells. In fact, research proved there is still a number of cells living in the post type 1 and type 2 diabetic patient, and it producing insulin. varies in their percentage. In type 1, about 10% of his cells is alive. In cases of type 2, yes, from 40 to 60% of his cells is alive. Actually, doctors depend on these living cells in his treatment of type 2 diabetes. So I started to read. What is the latest research did in this thing? They start stem cells, so-called the khalia design. Cells introduced by surgeon inside the pancreas to start to allow beta cells for production. This is a very good treatment, by the way, but for a lot of reasons, the results only showed 8% of success. This is because of lack of donors, immunological compatibility. For the same reason, in all the pancreatic transplantation surgery should be no reason of success, of this transplanted organ should be fresh only 8 hours after death or will be unusable. So, what stem cells did is that it allows reproduction in the beta cells so the body starts to produce insulin naturally again. I want to show you something. We as a fitting purpose could lead to cell production, right? Using a certain modality we use every day in our clinics. It's amazing. Laser is, you know, one of my professors know this more than me. Laser we need the class 3D wavelengths from 300 to 900 nanometers. Energy. The history of laser was first, experiment was by Candida Alphonse, who was in 1976. He started using laser in vitro. And it's making certain cells, starts to see what these cells would do if laser being potent. He showed a very strange thing. He saw that these cells start an enormous multiplication. Cells start to reproduce. So one of the most contraindications of laser, they always teach us in the university, never use laser on malignant cells. Because if I use it in malignant cells, this will lead to mitosis and cells will reproduce again and I'm killing the patient. So effective laser, FDA, through the Drug Administration, is a very great organization in the USA, have accepted the laser as a therapeutic modality to make cell reproduction anti-inflammatory and painful. I started to make some focus on how we did cell reproduction. There is a mechanism called the ROS, reactive oxygen species. It's a mechanism affecting cellular homeostasis and starts cell signaling and reproduction by production of certain enzymes. Laser affect the DNA of the cells, leading to DNA replication and start mitosis. So we're going to choose laser actually in case of meningitis fractures that now leads to cytokine regeneration. In cases of osteoarthritis, that have cartilage regeneration. In cases of ulcers, that have skin cells regeneration. You will be surprised that even dentists use laser in cases called the orthodontic movement. When there's a very old patient and you have a teeth you deal with, the doctor don't want to lose it, he put in some sessions of laser to allow osteocytes regeneration and did not lose his teeth. In fact, laser is being showing great results in cases of muscle tear. This is because of sensory regeneration. So the laser is designed to allow cellular replication in skin ulcers and others. But don't increase in the beta cells. And outside radiation starts to produce mitosis in the cells and cells starts to reduce again and naturally reduce insulin, just like the stem cells, but with something. I started to work in it and start to read the 30 articles from the most evidence-based articles and from very huge and good organizations to know how laser could affect more closely. I found that it increases some certain enzymes. First of them is cytochrome C-oxidase. Normally, we have in every cell of our body, including beta cells, we have a mitochondria. Mitochondria is an energy factory, as we know, it produces energy and allows the cells to do its function and reproduce. What happens in cases of diabetes is that the process called oxidative stress decrease occurs in the cytochrome C-oxidase. Normally, oxygen comes through the circulation and binds to have some receptor and in it called the oxygen receptor inside the mitochondria in the presence of cytochrome C-oxidase. So, cells start to use oxygen and it produces energy and actually live. What happens in case of diabetes is that the destruction occurs in decrease occurs in cytochrome C-oxidase. Actually, this video will demonstrate how low-level laser do this. Oxygen come to the mitochondria, bind to oxygen receptor, and they produce energy. This is normal. oxygen comes to this oxygen receptor and bonds to the in the to share in the electron transport chain and starts to in the presence of cyclotron COCs and starts this process. What happens in cases of diabetes? An increase occurs inside the cyclotron COC enzyme. Cells start to produce nitricoside. Nitricoside stands in oxygen receptor, actually blocks. So when oxygen comes to life, the nitricoside is in its receptor form. The nitricoside stands in its place. So cells do not reduce energy, and soon anaerobically starts to respire anaerobically, and it will soon die. But what happens in case of low level nasal irrigation? It starts to increase cyclotron COC states and relieve nitricoside from its place. So nitricoside starts to be unattached to its port. Oxygen starts to bind to the cells again, and it will start to produce energy normally as it was. This is positive stress. Second factor increases in presence of laser is a TGF, transforming growth factor, a major factor which is needed intensively to allow cell production in any cells, even the beta cells in my research. PFGF, basic fibroblastic growth factor, also is crucial for allowing cell production. It increases in cases of laser. VEGF, vascular endothelial growth factor, increases in cases of laser, and it's needed for cell reproduction. After all these guarantees, what is expected is mitosis, just like the osteoarthritis and osteoderma nervis. So one cell, I infected with laser, starts to reproduce, increase in number, and starts to allow cell reproduction. But this is something which is found in three research published in Israel and other countries. They found that laser increases IGF-1 insulin-like growth factor. It's a factor that's having the same molecular structure of insulin, actually doing the same effect of insulin. This increases in the presence of laser, and the reason for unknown cause, the increase in the serum by a huge percentage. This factor actually decreases in the cases of diabetes. In the diabetic patients, we have no IGF-1 out. Decreased IGF-1, we found laser increases for unknown cause. And this is what satisfies you. Now, they start to ask me, okay, you said this is a good purpose, but how you will deliver the laser to the beta cells, to the pancreas? This is a very easy endoscopic surgery, occurs for a lot of years, about 30 years right now, actually. This is a type of procedure that uses endoscope, minimally invasive, and called the ERCP, uncomplicated upper GI surgery. It's about a tube that the endoscopic surgeon uses, so we need an endoscopic surgeon in our team, actually. This is a tube, this is like a local anesthetic. Takes about 15 to 25 minutes, and the patient goes home at the same day. It's minimally invasive. And laser radiation to the laser tube could be attached to the scene to move in this part, actually in this procedure. The tube moves from the mouth to the esophagus, to the stomach, to the then to the pancreatic duct, and here we will reach pancreas. They did this experiment for a lot of years in the past. This is to make sure that there is any blockage in the laser in the pancreas or something. But we will use this procedure to allow the pancreas to take our laser medication with sufficient amounts. Actually, I sit with an endoscopic surgeon in Mahad Bahus, and she said, and I presented my research to him, and she said this is very safe and could be done in 25 minutes, actually, and this will be a great deal to make with a diabetic patient. To tell him, I will give you 2 to 3sessions of endoscope instead of injecting yourself 2 to 5 times per day. But this is attached also to the camera to see what's going on, so blindness inside the body. This procedure, I will monitor blood glucose for the diabetic patient between these sessions. I will make it for 2 to 3 times, actually, in my hepatitis until I am sure that blood glucose is being normalized. This is my research, but I'm having a message before I end. Actually, this is for all the students here. I'm talking about this, not to the students, not for professors and doctors. What about what about seeing a person with the same circumstances, same university, same sections? So if you see him every day in college, في القاعة دي ممكن يكون في 60 واحد مثلا 60 واحد دول أحسن مني لكن الناس دي they don't believe. They have idea but they didn't work on it. They didn't they said they انا معاكم اكتر واحد عارف ان السيركمستانسز اللي بتعدي منها دلوقتي مش حاجه مش مشجعه ابدا، لكن اللي انا شايفه ان انت لازم تتحدى كل الظروف دي، ساعتها النجاح او الفشل ده بيبقى على ربنا سبحانه وتعالى. I sort of this research 13 months ago. Some people laugh, others say you're crazy, others say you want only some credit. Today I went to several countries. Last one was from 3 weeks. I come from Oman to and good and take a prize for linguist research and highly appreciation prize for participation in linguist research. I'm having a great opportunity, inshallah, to go to Germany and in the next summer, inshallah. All of this, I didn't make any work. Any person in here could do what I did publicly. It's just your decide. It's your choice. Thank you.
وبرضه البحث بتاعه اخذ الجائزه الاولى في